stand. We're going to sing Doxology, hymn 668.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow.
Ask the Lord to prepare your heart for worship today. Ask the Lord to speak to you. You know, say, God, today I need you. I need you to speak to me. Speak through your word, Lord. Speak through a message in the song that we will sing. Just ask the Lord to give you an openness, heart willing to receive. After you pray that, just take your burden to the Lord. Whatever it is that's on your mind, take it to the throne of grace. Just take it before the Lord. Someone said this week, Jesus was more quick to go to the cross than we are to go to the throne of grace. So don't rob yourself. Go before the Father. Take that burden and cast it before the Lord. Father, prepare our hearts that we might worship you today in spirit and in truth. We thank you, Lord, for the wonderful privilege to call you our Heavenly Father. We thank you for all the benefits that come with knowing you. And Lord, part of our calling is to intercede. And Lord, we pause this morning to pray on behalf of every person here in this place. We pray that whatever specific need or burden or matter that's on the mind of your people in this room, Lord, I pray that you'll give peace and comfort. Help them to bring it before you, Lord. And then, Father, we come alongside these families that are praying, that are facing some difficult news potentially, are dealing with the reality of loss and death. And we pray for them. We come on their behalf. And Lord, we lift up Ronnie to you tonight and Megan. We pray that the Holy Spirit will be with them and will give them grace in their specific task and needs. We pray for Linda, Lord, as she awaits results. Give her peace and grace. We pray for Gerald Powell today. We pray for Tiffany Perry. We pray for the Nancy Bartley family, for Spencer Cobb. Lord, we pray for Denise Humphreys as she has knee surgery next Monday. Each one of these, Lord, represent a person, a family, a special burden, a special need. Some of them, it's an unknown, and there's a sense of fear. And we pray on their behalf that your grace will consume them right now, that your grace will comfort them, and that your presence will be a living reality for them right now in this time of need. Now, Father, we give ourselves to you. We yield to you now, and we pray that your Holy Spirit will minister through this time of worship, and we pray in Jesus' name, amen.
I invite you to stand once again and join me in singing hymn 149, Praise Him, Praise Him.
Praise Him, Praise Him. blessed Redeemer. Sing, O earth, His wonderful love proclaim. Hail Him, highest archangels in glory. Strength and honor give to His holy name. Like a shepherd, Jesus will guard His children. In His arms He carries them all day long. Praise Him, tell of His excellent greatness. Praise Him, ever in joyful song. Verse 3, praise Him, Jesus our blessed Redeemer. Heavenly portals, loud with hosannas ring. Praise the Savior, reigneth forever and ever. Crown Him, prophet and priest and king. Christ is coming over the world victorious.
Your face does not show it. Again, we're to the point where, oh, how I love Jesus. They're just words. They're not just words. Amen. Do you love Jesus this morning? Amen. Let your face show it. Fourth verse.
It tells of one whose loving heart can feel. My Savior, all.
Today our scripture reading is found in James chapter 1, verse 5. If any of you lacks wisdom, he should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to him.
Children's Church.
have your Bibles this morning, turn with me to the Gospel of John, chapter 8. We pick up where we left off toward the end of November as we get back in our study of the Gospel of John. Have you had those moments when earth-shattering or earth-shaking words have been shared with you? You remember those moments. It may be a time that you were sitting in a doctor's office. He looked you in the eyes and said, "You have cancer." Those are earth-shaking kind of words. Maybe you've received a phone call and on the other end was a loved one and they've had to break news to you that someone's very close to you was dead. I remember as a pastor in Tennessee, one early morning, about 3 a.m, my phone rang and Dr. Jerry Horn, a veterinarian doctor that was a member of our church, was calling and letting me know that a missionary that we had been working with for about 3 falls in a row, serving there in Honduras, had been ambushed while taking a group to Guatemala and had been murdered. Those were earth-shattering words. Maybe you have heard the words, "I want a divorce." Those were earth-shaking type of words. Maybe your child has looked you in the face and said, "I hate you." Those are earth-shaking kind of words. In John chapter 8, we find some earth-shaking words. And amazingly, they come from the mouth of Jesus. In chapter 8, verse 21, Jesus said to them, now let's see the context here. "Them" refers to the Jews. And in particular, it's referring to the teachers of the law. He is talking to the religious leaders. They were experts in the law of God. They were very religious. This was their life. This is what they lived for. And Jesus said to these religious leaders, "I am going away. And you will seek me and will die in your sin." Folks, that's not very politically correct. That's not very kind. What if you went up to somebody today out here, or let's say tomorrow you go to work and you're working and you bring some of your co-workers in and said, "I have something I need to say to you. I'm going away. You will seek me, but you're going to die in your sin." What would be their reaction? "Who are you to judge me? Who do you think you are?" And Jesus, to this religious crowd, says to them, "You will die in your sin. Where I go, you cannot come." Now, folks, I call that earth-shaking type of words. But when we look at it, we recognize that, yes, they're earth-shaking, but they come from the mouth of the man who was full of truth, the Son of God. And he is demonstrating that there are times in life that we must be honest with others. We must speak truth to others. We must speak what is right to others. And Jesus, he was speaking in such a way that this was earth-shaking for them. I don't know about you, but I know the morning that I got the call about this missionary, that shook me. It caused me to take a pause there. I remember the day my mother called and said, "Brad, your papa is dead." Now, the shocking news was not so much that my grandfather had died, he had been ill. But what was earth-shattering was that 2 days before that, I had led him to Christ.
It was earth-shaking in the sense that it hit me that my granddad was 2 days away from going to hell. That was earth-shaking. It was a time to pause and reflect and check out my priorities in life. And here Jesus is confronting the religious leaders of the day. And I believe his motivation was to shake them to the core, to cause them to examine, to cause them to reflect that all that they claimed to be was wrong. They were inaccurate about themselves. They were inaccurate about what they thought. They were inaccurate about their belief system. They were inaccurate about where they thought they were going. And then they very smugly and mockery respond to him in verse 22 by saying, will he kill himself? Because he's saying, where I go, you cannot come. The Jewish leaders were saying to him, well, listen, if we're not going where you're going, and we know where we're going to heaven. When we die, we're going to heaven. So I guess undoubtedly you're planning to commit suicide. And in the Jewish mind, the Jewish teachings, they believed that when you committed suicide, you not only went to hell, you went to the deepest, darkest, hottest part of hell. That was their teaching. So they assume, well, I guess you're going to commit suicide and you're going to hell because we know we are going to heaven. In this passage of Scripture, Jesus is revealing to what would be the most prominent, law-abiding, religious groups of the day that the direction they were heading were leading them straight down the highway to hell. I want to preach to you this morning on directions for the highway to hell. Jesus said there are two ways. Jesus said that there is a straight and narrow way where very few will go and be on that way that goes to heaven. But there is another way that is very broad and wide, and there will be many that go on that road. And Jesus is revealing here in this passage of Scripture that there are some signposts on the road of life that we need to examine to see which way am I going. And I want you this morning, as we look at the directions for the highway to hell, to make sure you're not seeing these kind of signs as you are traveling down that spiritual road. Because if you see these signs that he reveals in this passage, you're going down the wrong road, and you need to make a change quickly. Now, what are those signposts? What are those characteristics that he reveals about these individuals that he is specifically stating are going to hell? They're headed to hell. He says, you will die in your sin. Where I go, Jesus was going to heaven. He said, where I'm going, you're not going. You cannot come. So what are these characteristics? Well, let's look at this morning. Because when we see this startling statement, when we see these earth-shaking kind of words, it causes us to need to pause to examine. We need to look and make certain that we're not on the wrong road. And folks, let me tell you, God is not one day going to say, I'm going to make exception for this person. They didn't have as many opportunities. You know that John, we learned early in the Gospel of John that the Bible says that the true light enlightens every man. Do you realize that every single human being that has been born has enough light to know the truth? Jesus said that. He said the true light enlightens every man. And when you get into the book of Romans, Romans chapter 1 teaches that part of the light that enlightens has to do with creation. Romans 1 says that creation gives testimony to the fact that there is a God. And so God enlightens the mind of people that there's a God, that there's a way, and there's And there's only one way, and he does it through creation. Romans 2 goes further. Romans 2 says that God not only uses creation to enlighten man, but Romans 2 says that God also uses the conscience to enlighten man, that there is a God. That there is a holy God that we will stand before and that we will be accountable to. So the problem is not we don't have sufficient evidence. The problem is that we don't like the light. There's sufficient evidence, there's sufficient light, but the problem is man loves darkness rather than light. We prefer to keep our head in the sand. We love the darkness, and therefore we will be without excuse. So here we're listening in on a conversation. He is talking to experts in religion, and he reveals that the route that leads down the highway to hell is a route that, number one, gives way to self-sufficiency. That's what he's talking about here in verses 21 and 22. He is speaking to religious leaders, and they were pious, and they mocked him when he questioned them. When they're saying, well, I guess you're going to commit suicide because we are going to heaven. You know what they're saying? They are saying to Jesus, we don't need a Savior. We are good enough. We do all of these good things. I mean, we're above average in our lifestyle. And look at all the things that we're a part of and the things we support and the good things that we teach. And we try to lead people properly. But they could not recognize that they had a sin problem. They would not admit that they had a problem before God and that they needed a Savior. But Jesus said to them, no, you're not going to heaven. You cannot get to heaven on your good works. You are headed to hell. Now, the Jews of that day, they had a salvation teaching that believed that getting to heaven was through human achievement. They believed that it was by works of righteousness, which we do, that would get us to heaven. And Jesus is literally chopping at the very root of that system that they taught. And he is saying to them, your system is wrong. Your mindset is wrong. Your thinking is wrong. That's why in the New Testament you see it over and over, the emphasis that it's not by works of righteousness which we have done, but it is according to his mercy that we are saved. That's why Paul writes to the church at Ephesus and says to them that we are saved by grace through faith and that it is not of works, lest we should boast. We're not saved by good works. We cannot be saved by good works. That's why Paul, in the book of Romans, as he is teaching his Jewish brethren, listen to what Paul writes in Romans chapter 10. He says, brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel. Now that represents the Jewish people. It represents the people Jesus is confronting right here, the Jewish leaders. He says, my heart's desire for the Jews is that they may be saved. Well, I tell you what, when those Jews heard that letter being read, they were saying, well, who do you think you are, Paul? Are you saying that we're not saved? What do you mean that you hope that we'll be saved? And then verse 2, he writes this, for I bear them witness that they have a zeal for God. You hear that? He said they have a zeal. They're zealous about God. They believe in God. But it's not according to knowledge. They have the wrong thinking about what they believe in God. In verse 3, for they being ignorant of God's righteousness and seeking to establish their own righteousness have not submitted to the righteousness of God. He is saying everything that you are teaching, everything that you believe concerning salvation is upside down. And Jesus said, I'm ready to turn it right side up. What you believe about being saved is based on good works. You think that you're good. You think you're self-righteous. You think you're self-sufficient and you're depending on self. And you think that by nature you're good. And Jesus is saying by nature you're bad. You're a sinner, and your teaching is flawed, and you must come to the realization that you will die in your sin if you continue down the route of self-righteousness. Now, we need to examine ourselves. There are times that when we come to the Scripture causes us to pause. Are you depending on your good works as the measure and merit of getting you to heaven? Are you depending on something you've done that is going to get you to heaven? Because Jesus is directly teaching against that. He is saying to them, yes, you think you are good and you're living by self-righteousness, but you will be separated from me. So the route that leads down the highway to hell is a route of self-righteousness. But then verse 23, he takes it to another signpost. He said, as you're headed down the highway to hell, you'll not only see the sign of self-righteous way, you will then see a second sign. And he mentions it in verse 23. And he said to them, you are from beneath. I am from above. You are of this world. I am not of this world. Therefore, I said to you, you will die in your sins. Folks, when Jesus says something one time, that ought to cause you to take attention. When he says it three times, that ought to make a person stop and say, I need to listen close. He has said once, you will die in your sin. He has said twice, now you will die in your sin. And then in verse 23, he says it again, or verse 24, you will die in your sins. He says it three times to them. You will die in your sins. Now, what is he talking about here? He said, you're from beneath. I'm from above. Well, if you'll go with me, hold your place here in John and go to his writings in 1 John. 1 John chapter 2. I was sharing with somebody the other day that when I first recommitted my life to Christ, I didn't know anything about the Bible. If you would have said, hey, you know, where's Genesis? I would have said, I don't know what that is. I don't know where it's located. And the first passage I ever read when I began my journey with Christ was in 1 John. The first passage was this passage, 1 John chapter 2, verse 15. Listen to what it says. It says, do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but it is of the world. And the world is passing away, and the lust of it, but he who does the will of God abides forever. Now, John in 1 John is describing what Jesus is talking about here in the Gospel of John. Jesus said to them, you are from beneath. I am from above. You are of this world. I am not of this world. And because you're of this world, you will die in your sin. So what is he talking about? You know, when he says, love not the world, what is he talking about? Does it mean I can't say that's a beautiful scenery? Can I not say when I'm out in the woods, man, it's a beautiful world? Is that what he's talking about? Well, John makes it clear he's not talking about creation. He's talking about a system. And we know that we live in a world system that has a prince, and his name is devil. His name is Satan. He is the prince of the power of the air. He is in charge of this world system that we live in. This world system, as one preacher said, it exists by materialism. It is controlled by humanism. It is filled with sex. It is filled with carnal ambition. It is filled with pride and greed and self-pleasure and self-desire. And that's why James in his writing said, friendship with the world, speaking of the world system, is enmity with God. Now, what does that mean? Jesus is saying to the Jewish leaders here that you are in love with this system. You have a passion for power. You have covetousness for things. You are arrogant in your attitude. Let me tell you, arrogancy and covetousness and all of these things of self-pleasure and greed and pride, they are part of the world system. And he says to these Jewish leaders, you are consumed with these things. You're preoccupied with the system. You're living for it. You are full of it. You're full of it. And he said, the way of worldliness does not lead down the highway to heaven. It leads down the highway to hell. The religious leaders, though outwardly they looked like they had it all together and they looked so clean and good and pure and perfect, they were obsessed and possessed with a love for the system of this world. And he says, you're not from above. You're controlled by that which is below. The way of worldliness is a sign you'll see on the highway to hell. You're traveling down the highway and you see the highway sign of self-righteousness. I don't need a savior. I'm good. I have a good heart. I do good things. And then you keep down that road and you see the sign, the way of worldliness, assuming compassion for the system of this world that 1 John talks about. But then there's a third sign that you'll run into in verse 24. He said, therefore I said to you, you will die in your sins. For if you do not believe that I am he, you will die in your sins. There's the third sign, and that is unbelieving. Not believing. Not believing. You remember the old Philippian jailer? He was convicted with his need. He realized he was a sinner. His passion for this worldly system had died, and he said, what must I do to be saved? And here's the answer, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved. The highway to hell is a highway that's littered with signs that says no to Christ. It says, I don't believe, I don't believe. It is filled with signs of unbelieving. And Jesus said, I'm the only way. Now, what does it mean to believe? It means that we believe that Jesus is who he said he was. We believe that Jesus is one with the Father, that he is part of the Trinity, that he is God, that he is incarnate man. He is the God-man. He was virgin-born. He was sinless. He gave his life as an atonement for sin. He satisfied the righteous demands of a holy God. That's what we're to believe about Jesus. We don't believe that he's just a sweet little thing that we make place for in our life. We come to him as King and Lord and God, and we surrender and yield to him and let him take control rather than still holding on to control and just letting him ride along in the side carriage. Believing is total yielding. It's coming to the place that we say it's Jesus alone, Jesus plus nothing. Now that means that we take nothing away from what he said. If you take anything away from what Jesus said about himself, you will die in your sins. You take anything away. If you say, well, I believe everything but the virgin birth, you'll die in your sins. I believe everything except that he paid for the sins of man. You die in your sins. Jesus said, we are to believe that he is who he is. We are to believe that he is the I am. That's what he says there. If you do not believe that I am he, you will die in your sins. If you do not believe that I am everything that I have shown you that I am and that I've done, that I am the Messiah, that I am the only way, you will die in your sins. Don't take away anything. If you're depending on a faith that's less than that, you will die in your sins. But let me tell you something. On the other side, it's just as dangerous. If you add anything to that, you will die in your sins. You add anything other than the fact that Jesus alone saves. It's Jesus plus nothing, folks. It's Jesus plus nothing. There are those that say, well, I believe everything you have said. I believe everything about Jesus that you've said. But I believe you also need to be confirmed. Or you need to go through confirmation classes. And then you're saved. I believe everything you said about Jesus. I believe it all. But I believe you also need to and have to be baptized to be saved. You will die in your sins. You are adding to what Christ has said. Jesus is being forthright. He is being truthful. He is being honest. He is saying it is Jesus plus nothing. See, when you say it's Jesus plus one more thing, You're saying Jesus is not sufficient. You are saying Jesus cannot save me alone. I have to add a good work. I have to do one thing. I have to accomplish this, and then everything's good. No, you have added to the gospel. And Jesus said, you will die in your sins, and you cannot come where I am at. A highway to hell is littered with signs that say self-sufficient. It's littered with signs that say love the world. It's littered with signs that say unbelieving. Oh, you say, but I believe in God. So what? James said the devils in hell believe that Jesus is God, and they're all going to spend forever in hell. It's not just saying, oh, I believe in God. No, it is coming to the place of saying, I yield to Jesus alone. It is Jesus alone who saves. Jesus plus nothing who saves. And then there's one last sign that we see on the highway to hell in verse 25. Then they said to him, who are you? I think you could take that in several ways. First of all, they were probably saying, who do you think you are? Some of you are saying that about me right now. Who do you think you are telling us that I'll die and go to hell if I believe that it's Jesus plus something? That's what they said to Jesus. Who do you think you are? Well, Jesus was the Son of God. Jesus spoke truth. And he spoke it to people that were headed to hell. And folks, he did it out of love. He did it out of honesty. I was looking up last night. Margaret texted me and said, it's game time. I said, no thanks. As you know, Kentucky played Arkansas last night. And I thought, I'm not going to put myself through that, you know? I mean, Andrew, he's a better fan than me. He did. He stayed up and watched it and hung in there. And I thought, I'm not doing it. I want to have a good spirit in the morning, you know? I mean, I want to wake up happy. I went to bed about the time. But before I went, I read and did some studying, and I went to my website and found some information. And one of the things that I found, I just was curious, how many people die a year? How many people die a year in the world? Well, this site said 100 people die every minute. 100 people die every minute. 6,000 people die every hour. 144,000 people die every day. 55 million people die every year. I got thinking about that. 55 million people die every year. 100 every minute. 100 every minute. What did Jesus say about dying? He said, there's going to be people when they die that think they're going to heaven, they find out they're not. Remember what he said? He said, there's going to be those that day said, Lord, Lord, didn't we do these things in your name? And Jesus, we said this in your name. And Jesus is going to say to them, depart from me, I never knew you. So Jesus is reminding us, there's some people think they're going to heaven, they're going to find out wrong, they're going to hell. Jesus also said that the way to hell is very wide, and there would be many that go that way, and the way to heaven is very narrow and straight, and there will be few that go that way. And so I got to thinking, 55 million, out of that 55 million, some of them died thinking they were going to heaven, and they found out they were going to hell. Some of them thought they were on a straight and narrow, and literally they were on the wide. What percentage of that 55 million went to heaven, and what percentage went to hell? If you look at the Bible and see that Jesus was very narrow-minded in his teaching about going to heaven, it was probably a very small percentage. So we're talking millions upon millions upon millions every year are perishing and dying and going to hell. But I'm afraid that within the church, there are those that Jesus dealt with that think they're going to heaven and they're going to hell because what they believe is not what he said and what he taught. We believe that, well, I'm good at my nature is I'm good. I just believe that the pendulum is going to, the good is going to outweigh the bad and I'm going to get there. That's why I do all these good things. And we see that Jesus said, no, you'll die in your sin. And we think, oh, God will make an exception. I know that I love the world. I know I'm obsessed with the world. I'm more consumed with the world than the things of heaven. And we just think, well, God makes an exception. If I'll just be sincere enough that he'll make an exception. And he says, no, you will die in your sins. And then we say, well, what about that guy? He's very sincere. He believes in Buddha. And you know, he's a sincere Muslim. And surely God will take an account of that. And Jesus said, no, you will die in your sins if you do not believe that I am he. And then you have this final sign that he says to them. They said, who are you? And Jesus said, just what I have been saying to you from the beginning. You know what signpost this is? Ignorance. They could have said it, who do you think you are? But I think in a way they were saying, who are you? And he said, what? You're asking me, who am I? You have seen me perform miracles. You have heard me teach. You have literally said, you speak as one with authority. We've never heard anybody speak the way you speak. You have healed the blind. You have set free the demon possessed. You have had power over creation by stilling the water. You have had power over the supernatural by removing demons from the bodies of individuals. You saw these things. You heard me teach. You have watched my walk. You have seen my life. And you're asking me, who are you? It's like they ignorance was bliss for them. Just keep us in the dark. We just hope. We hope. We're going to get there. Jesus said to them, you will die in your sins. Where I go, you cannot come. He had offered them light, and they loved the darkness more. Then Jesus says to them in verse 28, when you lift up the Son of Man, then you will know that I am he, and that I do nothing of myself, but as my Father taught me, I speak these things. He says to them, you know what? You're going to finally know the truth. Because I'm going to be lifted up. And here he's talking about his crucifixion. And he said, I am going to be crucified, and I'm going to die. And you're going to know. You're going to know that I am he. Because there is going to be a centurion that's going to say, truly, this is the Son of God. You're going to see the veil of the temple rent in two from the top to the bottom. You're going to see dead people rise from the grave. You're going to know that I rose from the dead. You're going to know it. You know what? They did know it. You know they paid off the guards who were guarding the tomb? They knew he rose from the dead. They gave them money to keep their mouth shut, but they knew he rose from the dead. They knew that. And then he said, you're going to see me ascend to the heaven, and you're going to see a church established, and it's going to rock this world. You're going to see people that were enmeshed in Judaism that are going to be dynamically transformed and saved and have a new life. He said, then you will know that I am Jesus, that I am he, that I am the Lord, that I am the only way. Verse 29, and he who sent me is with me. The Father has not left me alone, for I always do those things that please him. You see, they had mocked him and mocked him about where he was going and who he was. And he said, you claim to know the Father, but you don't know him at all. You don't know him at all. Because if you knew him, you would know me. The highway to hell is a busy road. And it scares me to think that there are people who have names on church membership rolls that are on that highway. Now, folks, we've been studying the Gospel of John. We've been making our way through it. And this happens to be where we are today. And you happen to be where you are. And this isn't coincidence. This is divine appointments. If you're here this morning, how will you react to the words of Christ? How would you have reacted that day if you were in that crowd? And he said to you, you will die in your sins. You will not come where I'm going. And you kind of fletch up. Well, I'm a good person. Who do you think you are telling me that I'm going to go to hell? But you know by your life, and you know by the road sign that you see controlling your life, that what you see is self-righteousness. You see worldliness. You see ignorance. You see that truly you have not yielded totally to the person of Christ, but you're trying to save yourself. You're adding to what he has said, or you've taken away, and you're going to continue to live there when he makes it so clear. There's a way for you. There's a way for you to be saved. In verse 29, these wonderful words, or verse 30 says, and as he spoke these words, remember what I said when he began, I'm sure there were people bristling up and they were mad and they were like ready to fight. But he was honest. He told the truth. He confronted them. It always amazes me when Christians come to me and they get mad when I preach on hell. When I confront folks with, you must be saved, and you need to consider, are you saved? And if we don't follow the prescription of getting to heaven that he laid out, folks get upset. Oh, I just think you were a little bit too narrow-minded there. I think you were a little bit too forthright there. Jesus was. He was. He was. And because he was, look what happened, verse 30. As he spoke these words, many believed in him. Who do you think the many represented? I think they represented the people he was talking to, the Jewish leaders. Many believed on him. They realized we're on the highway to hell. We better do something about it. I went over Friday night, took care of my grandson with my wife, and we had the joy of waking up so that the parents could sleep some, and Luke thought that it'd be great to have a snack about 4 a.m, and I had a talk with him. I said, you know, this is kind of early, you know, to be having snack time. You know, we need to get on a better schedule here. So I had, you know, he looked at me and said, you know, I'm in control, you know. You're on my time. So I gave him this snack, and Libby had helped preparing it, and we got him to eat, got him back to sleep, and 7 o'clock, he decided he wanted to have something again, you know, and I'm like, no, wait just a minute, you know, you just ate at 4, and so I'm feeding him again, and so we've tried to, you know, give them a break, and by the time the next day rolled around, I'm weary, I'm like, you know, boy, I'm a little old to have a little baby to take care of, and not as young as we used to be, and so I'm a little weary, but Libby, you know, she had these plans, and she drugged me yesterday. I was drugged by my wife. She drugged me to the mall. And so we're headed, you know, from Lexington, headed to Simpsonville. Oh, yeah, the great outdoor mall there that has 1,000 stores, and half of them have shoes in them. And my wife, you know, needs another pair of boots. And I'm like, what does a woman need more than one pair of boots for? But, you know, they do. And so we're going from store to store, and we're looking for things. And my body's weary, and I've been drugged through shopping, and I'm becoming famished. You know, I haven't had anything to eat, and we need to get something to eat, and I want to go home. And you know, my shopping, enthusiasm had died, and it was gone. And finally, she was ready to go, and we got in the car. You know, and I'm thinking, you know, I'm ready to get home. And she said, well, you know, she's punching in that missing. You know, those cars, aren't they amazing? You've got a woman beside you telling you how to drive, and you got a woman in the car yelling at you where to go. And so I hit that newbie, you know, and I say, go home. And I hit go home. And Libby said, oh, I hope that's not going to take us, you know, down through there. And we hit those curvy roads going through Grants and all that. And I'm thinking, well, I don't know, but if that's the shortest way, that's the way we're going, you know. So I'm in there, and I'm weary, I'm ready to get something to eat, I'm tired of shopping, and I'm not thinking real clear, and I'm just following the Miss Newbie there. And, you know, in my mind, I'm thinking, okay, we came this way, it's probably going to take us back to Frankfort, you know, and then we'll go back to Owenton. And so that's what I have on my mind. And we're doing what we do, following its directions, and get on the road, and then realize, we're not headed toward Frankfort, we're headed toward Louisville. We're going to Louisville. Why is it taking us toward Louisville? Well, you know, it got us there, and it probably was end up being quicker. But in my mind, I was like, I'm going the opposite direction that I was planning to go. I was headed toward Frankfort. But no, Sign says you're going to Louisville, so we're going to Louisville. And you know, I had to make a choice. Well, do I keep going or do I make a drastic decision? Well, in life, thank goodness, Miss Newby has a way of redirecting you and getting you home when you think you should go one way. When you're on the spiritual highway, there's only one way. And this morning, if you're driving down the highway and you see a sign and it says self-righteous, and you keep going and you see worldliness, and you keep going and you see unbelieving, you need to wake up and realize that you're not headed to heaven, you're headed to hell. And you need to do something quickly and drastically. Folks, you need to be like these crazy people on the highway that when they see they're going the wrong way or they want to avoid some traffic jam, they cross the median. They go down into the median and cross over and turn and get back on the highway because they're going the wrong way. Or you see the first exit and you whip off of there and go over the overpass and get back on the right road and you head the direction that you intended to go. You need to do the same thing today. You need to realize these road signs are saying, hell, hell, hell. You're headed down the highway to hell. Get off of this highway and get on the highway to heaven. Get on the highway to heaven. And you can do that today. You can do it today. You can believe the same way they believed. You need to come today and say, oh God, I'm a sinner and I'm not good enough. I'm not righteous enough. I am a sinner and I need a Savior. You need to admit to God you're a sinner. And you need to admit that Jesus is the only way and you need to believe in Him with all your heart. You need to yield your life to Him. You need to turn over the reins of your life to Him. You need to say, I'm not going to be a part of this worldly system. I'm not going to be passionately in love with this system, but I'm going to be in love with the God of heaven who made all things. And I'm not going to remain in darkness. I'm not going to remain in ignorance. I'm going to face the truth and I'm going to believe the truth. And the truth will save your soul. You need to come to Christ. You need to yield your life to Jesus. You may be a member, but you need to be saved. You need to come to Jesus and be saved. Today is the day that you can come. We're going to sing together hymn number 413, Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus. And as we sing, I want to invite you to come. I want you to step out. I want you to just step out like I'm driving down the highway to hell, but right now I'm fixing to step up and I'm fixing to get on the highway to heaven. Come, and I'll help you. I'll help you to make the decision that'll get you on the right road. Would you stand?